makes my heart come alive. Suddenly brought to life when I met you. Reaching beyond the skies, running deep, stretching wide. Perfect love realized here with you.
Come on now.
Now the sun is for real, you will never let go. Never let go. Oh, it's more than just words, love beyond my control. Out of control.
Heads up!
This is real love. This is real love.
You're pulling good afternoon. Yes.
Evening,
afternoon, wherever you at. It's 5 o'clock somewhere. Whether it's morning, noon, or night. So we thank you so much for joining in with us tonight. You may hear some background noise, like the music. Just keep on trying. What she said. So tonight, let us pray. Eternal God, our Father, we thank you for your grace. We thank you for your mercy. Father, we ask now that you give us strength to teach your holy and divine word. For we ask it all in the name of Jesus that we do pray. Amen. 1 Samuel chapter number 18. 1 Samuel chapter 18. First Samuel chapter 18. First Samuel chapter 18, verse number 1 says, "Now when he had finished speaking to Saul, the soul of Jonathan was knitted to the soul of David, and Jonathan loved him as his own soul." I'm going to stop there.
I feel like I missed something.
18. 18 and 1. Jesus. 18 and 1. Lord help us. So tonight we see that we are in part 3 of and it's going to get a little weird, very much so. Very much so, to the point, y'all are not going to like me after this, which is totally fine. This particular section of Bible is the word I'm looking for. Hey Doc, it can be confusing. If we go back to last week, we talked about, who do we talk about? It's a shame.
You don't even know.
We talked about David and Bathsheba. We talked about the love trip triangle and what's another word? But anyway, then we talked prior to first time was Samson and Delilah, which also was a family affair. So tonight, we're going to talk about a relationship that a lot of people don't talk about, and that is David and Jonathan. Please follow me and hear me very well. This study can be a little awkward because Jonathan is Saul's son. And Saul is upset because David has got appointed to be king. If you don't believe me, go back to chapter 16. Okay? Chapter 16. He gets appointed as king. And Saul has a problem because Saul lost his appointment. So what happened is David gets appointed as king. He does not take his rightful place until the Lord says so. Can I put this in there for free? Some people are putting themselves in place and the Lord has not appointed you yet. It is not your turn. And so what happens is there will become all kinds of calamity, all kinds of confusion, because it's not your set time. Okay? So what happened is Jonathan is knitted to David. And so what happens is that they will, they're so close to one another, and they are, they're besties. Are besties to the point where Jonathan tells David that his father is out to kill him. To the point when David runs away from Saul, because Saul was trying to kill him, what happened was is that Jonathan also went, he was loyal, watch the word, he was loyal to David compared to his father. He was not loyal to his dad because the dad had a motive to kill him, to kill his best friend. And sometimes in life, people will have a motive to kill your surroundings. Hey, glory. Will kill your surroundings because they are intimidated by them. Some people are, can I put this in there for free? Some people are intimidated by your anointed. Hey, shata. They are intimidated by your anointed. And so what happens is, the text says, now when he had finished speaking to Saul, the soul of Jonathan, watch this, the soul of Jonathan was knitted to the soul of David. So in other words, they was connected together. So I know everybody has heard that, when you're having pillow talk or having relations, there are soul ties. Here, it's going to get, juicy quickly. So what happens is the soul tie that Jonathan has is to David. And likewise, David also has a soul tie to Jonathan. So it is a mutual soul tie that keeps them connected as one. Watch the text, because what happens is, it says, and Jonathan loved him as his own soul. I love you so much that I'm connected to you. Who's to say, because it has been studied, that Jonathan has saw David unrobe himself. It has some people you cannot allow to see you unrobe. You cannot allow everybody to see you butt booty naked. You can't allow everybody to see unless there is a connection to that individual or that person that you want them to see you butt booty naked. And so what happens here in the text, it says, and Saul took him that day and would not let him go home to his father's house anymore. Then Jonathan and David made a covenant because he loved him as his own soul. Wait a minute. Now I've got a covenant. Some preachers and pastors won't teach this. Now David and Jonathan has a covenant
covenant together as one. In other words, when we make a covenant or a vow, don't get confused, and I'm not promoting any certain type of sexuality, but I'm telling you, it's in the text that David and Jonathan was connected. It is, they made a covenant together. They did that. I was not there when they made the covenant. I don't know if they said, well, bruh, you got my back, I got your back. You scratch mine, I scratch yours. I was not there. The Bible says that they had a covenant to one another, but to the point that they loved each other to the soul. Can you say the person that you're laying with David? The person that you are laying with day in, day out, and I'm glad you think it's funny, day in and day out, that you are connected, that you love them so much to the soul, because some people that you lay with, you're not really in love with them. You see, the Bible says that your eyes are lustful. And so what happens is when you look at them, Granny always said your eyes are bigger than your belly. And so what happens is that some people that you're laying with or you having pillow talk with is because your eyes was bigger than your belly, to the point that hard-headed Negro that won't get up off of the couch and go get a job. What happens is you have allowed him, because there's a soul tie there. You won't allow your soul will say, I take care of you, baby. You ain't got to do nothing. That's like Betty, not Betty, but Barbara and Shirley. The clothes on his back, I buy. The car that he drives, I pay for. Some of y'all are in the same predicament, because you rather be connected with the pillow talk instead of allowing God to do some transformation. So what happens is David and Jonathan has a covenant together. And so what happens is he says that he loved him so much. He says this on multiple occasions. He said it in verse number 1. And then we see in verse number 3, he says it again. Then he says, watch the text in verse number 4. And Jonathan took off his robe that was on him and gave it to David with his armor. Wait a minute, hold up, wait a minute. In reality, some people, grown folk, if you understand the mentality here, is that I will give my shirt off my back for my friend. Watch the text, but in the text it says that he derobed himself. Jonathan got butt booty naked. He derobed himself to the point, not only did he derobe himself, but he also gave David his armor. Now, wait a minute. David and Jonathan has a tight relationship, that they're knitted together. One. Then two, they love each other to the soul, to the core. I love you past the heart. In other words, can you really say that you love somebody past the heart? Because in this text, it tells me, I know for sure that y'all got that one individual that you just love. I love you. I go here and I go there for you because you my bae and all of that. Y'all know how y'all are, because the text says that you have a lustful eye. Watch this. God, I'm all up in y'all's Kool-Aid. Know every one of y'all's flavors. Here it is. He says, so he derobed himself. He gave it to David with his armor, even to his sword and his bow and his belt. Watch this. So David went out wherever Saul sent him and behaved wisely. And Saul sent him over the men, set him over the men of war. And he was accepted in the sight of all people, and also the sight of Saul's servants. Now it had happened as they were coming home, when David was returning from the slaughter of the Philistines, that the woman had come out of all of the cities of Israel, singing and dancing to meet the king, to meet King Saul, with tambourines, with joy, and with musical instruments. So the woman sung as they danced and said, Saul has slain his thousands, And David had, and David his 10,000s. And then, watch this, then Saul was very angry, and the same displeased him. And he said, they have ascribed to David 10,000. And to me, they have ascribed only 1,000. Now, what more can he have but the kingdom? So Saul eyed David. Y'all know how y'all do. Y'all eye folk. Y'all look them up and down, or y'all roll your eyes and get, you know, pissy mad and so forth and so on. You eyed that person. You eyed them. He eyed them from that day forward. In other words, what happens is that Saul had a motive against David. He had a plot against David. And what happens is, y'all know how folk are, they will have an underlying agenda or an underlying motive that will cause them to look at you differently. Y'all, maybe I'm the only one that understands that some people will smile in your face but stab you in the back. It's in the text. It's in the text. And because what happens is Saul was cool until the people came back with a different report. Who I told the teens on last night, whose report do you believe? In the text, he says that the people, they had a celebration. Can you celebrate people who are mad at you? Can you still give them a round of applause? Can you still tell them, pat them on the back when they are at their lowest point in life? He says, and it happened on the next day that the distressing spirit, watch this, it is a spirit, distressing spirit from God came upon Saul. What happens when God is your problem, not the anointed one? You better write that down for me. What happens when God is your problem and not the assigned or the anointed one? Watch this. He says in the text, and the distressing spirit from God came upon Saul, and he prophesied inside of the house. So watch the text. He says, so David played music with his hands, as at other times. But there was a spear in Saul's hand, and Saul cast the spear, for he said, I will pin David to the wall. But David escaped his presence twice. Here it is. Now Saul was afraid of David because the Lord was with him. But he departed from Saul. Therefore, Saul removed him from his presence and made him his captain over 1,000. And he went out and came in before the people. And David behaved wisely in all his ways. Judge your mama, not me. And the Lord was with him. Therefore, when Saul saw the behavior, that he behaved very wisely, he was afraid of him. But all Israel and Judah loved David because he went out and came in before them. Here it is. Can you live with yourself when God removes his hand off of you? Here the text said that Saul removed him from the presence and he made him the captain. Watch this. Let me go back. Hit verse number 12. Verse number 12 says, now Saul was afraid of David because the Lord was with him, but had departed from Saul. what happens or what would happen if the Lord departed from you? Here's the problem. Some of you are walking around like dead zombies because the Lord has departed from you, and you're walking and you thinking everything is well. You think all is well and everything's under control. You think God is on your side. You think God is moving in your direction. You find in favor with God. But can I be honest with you? God has departed from you. You're just walking around in a daze and thinking I'm blessed and highly favored. I'm blessed in the city, blessed in the field. I'm blessed coming in, blessed going out. But in reality, God has departed from you because you have messed up the anointing or the flow of the oil. Watch this, because Saul was so jealous and he envied David because of other people. Man, what happens, or why do we allow other people to cause us to be envious and jealous of the anointed one? Because here's the reason why, is because we think that if we are in the corner with them and we are on their side, we think that we're getting ahead. But in reality, you're moving backwards because you have a spirit of envy and jealousy. He says God is the only one that should be jealous. Here's the reason why. He says, I am a jealous God, because he does not want anything before him, anything, any place, or anyone before him. And the problem of the matter is that sometimes we put people, places, and things before God instead of allowing God to do the transformation. Watch the text. Because Saul got so messed up, and not only did he get messed up, but he also understood, he realized that he was out of God's grace because he was worried about what David was doing and where David was going. Can I be honest with you tonight? Stop worrying about your neighbor. Stop worrying about Pookie. Stop worrying about Boo Boo. Because in reality, it's not about them. It's all about him. Here. He says, and watch what David did, is that David went in. He also went back to the house where Saul was. He moved accordingly. And what he does is, he says, he behaved, the text said, and David behaved wisely in all of his ways, and the Lord was with him. When you behave wisely, when you are in the right position at the right time, when you are in prayer and in fasting, what God will do is he will reward you. Watch this. David did not get caught up in the pillow talk in verse number one through four. He did not get caught up in the pillow talk because he understood the assignment, because what people had placed on, because people had already placed him in a category. He says, "Nah, bro, I've got too much to live for. I've got too much to fight for." And can I be honest with you? When was the last time you have fought? Man, I'm talking. When have you fought for the anointing of your life? Because what happens is, some of us will be are anointed, but we don't fight for the anointing. We think it just comes automatic. Can I be honest with you? It does not happen overnight. It's not automatic. Here it is, because you have to have some tests. You have to have some trials. That's why the Bible says, he says, and you shall have trials and tribulation, but be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. In other words, the crushing, the beating, the heartache, the hardship, the headaches, all of that is to mold you and to crush you and to develop you, to allow oil to flow from the olive. That's the problem, is that you don't want to be those things. You don't want to trust the process. You don't want to go through the storm. You don't want to go through the rain. But can I be honest with you? It has to build you. In other words, I told the youth or the teens on yesterday, is that the trials and tribulations is to develop your faith. If your faith has not been developed, that means there's a problem. It is not a problem with God. It's a problem with you. In other words, that means you have to allow God to shift that. Man, you got to allow God to shift things, because what happens is, when he shifts things in your life, that that means you can't be surrounded by any and everybody, because some people are here to drain you, not to pour into you. Sometimes life will give you lemons. You've got to make lemonade out of it. And in the text is, the lemon was the sour lemon. If I have to use an old Bible study, the sour lemon in the text is Saul. But what David does is he uses Saul's imperfection as a, watch this, or imperfection or his proclivity. He uses that as a momentum to move in the way God wants him to move. Can you shift when everybody is standing still? Can you steal when people says, hey baby, at that 10 o'clock hour, and they text you and say, hey baby, come over. Let me see you. Let me do this. Let me do that to you. Can you still shift and allow God to steal, get the glory out of your life? Because watch this, some people will allow the selfishness or the lustful spirit to rise up, and they will have the pillow talk. Songwriter said, I think it, you know, you got it on your phone. The songwriter said, can we talk for a minute? You listen to it today. In other words, some people will speak sweet nothings in your ear, and you fall head over heels. When was the last time you fell head over heels for God? When was the last time you told God, I love you despite who I am and what I am, what I'm doing, despite the sin that I'm committing? I still love you. I still adore you. I still worship you. Because you're so worried about everybody else and everything else, you can't tell God thank you. So, in other words, you've got to be like David. Watch the text. David says, he tells us, is that he began to play an instrument. He began to give God adoration. He began to use his hands. He began to use his craft. And verse number 6, he tells us is that there was a woman. Not only did David was anointed to play, but there was also a woman who also sung and danced. In other words, can you use the power and the anointing in your hands to do what the Lord called you to do? Here's the problem. You can't do that. You can't utilize that because you're worried about somebody who's laying next to you. Y'all know Shirley Murdoch. Can we lay? You got it on your phone too. Can we lay or Silk? There's a meeting in my bedroom. You worried about all of that. And can I be honest with you? You've got to get connected with God. Here it is. And then I'm done. Here it is. There is a shift taking place. You've got to be in a position to shift. If you're not ready to shift, what are you doing? You're staying stagnant. You're staying still. He says, I get it that God said, stand, be still and know that I'm God. I get it. I understand that. I want you to do the same thing. I want you to do the same thing. Be still and know that He is God. He's worthy of all things. He is getting ready to give a spirit of abundance. And what happens is you've got to be ready to receive the abundance. That's why he wrote Malachi chapter number 3, verse number 10. He says that he will open up the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing that you cannot contain or you cannot withhold, you cannot hold. In other words, that means there is overflow. He says he's ready to fill you up that your cup may overflow. So I believe God is getting ready to shift some things. And when he does it, you have to be ready for the shift. Okay? Any thoughts, questions, observations? Any thoughts, questions, observations?
Can we type it on here?
No, I think they can hear me. You got a question? You know if you had a question or not? Thoughts, questions, observations? If not, we thank you so much for joining in tonight. We thank you for you doing your part. And so we thank you, we thank you, we thank you. Listen, this coming Sunday, I want to invite all that can. Please come out at 5 o'clock for Glory Night. For Glory Night, 5 o'clock. We are at 2910. Fort Campbell Boulevard, Hopkinsville, Kentucky, 42240. Please come be our guest, 5 p.m. Glory Night. You can wear your African attire, please, or come comfortable. because we are going to travail. We're going to travail, and we're going to pray, and we're going to ask, we're going to bombard heaven, and ask him to grant us access to the holies of holies. So with that being said, if there's no questions, thoughts, observations, let us pray. Eternal God, our Father, we thank you for all that you are doing. We thank you for your tender mercy, your loving kindness. We thank you for your strength. We thank you for the ability to study your holy and divine word. Father, we ask now that everyone that will watch this, we ask now that you grant them power to live right, power to do right, power to be what you called them to be. For we ask it all in the name of Jesus that we do pray.